So thank you for coming to my presentation. The title is Fatigue Damage of the Cement Sheath in Oil and Gas Wells. And so first of all, why or do we even care about this fatigue damage or damage in cement in wells? So first of all, I just have a drawing of a pseudo well. And so this shows the formation, the casing, and the cement. And the purpose of this cement is to seal the well from gas movement between like different formations in the well or to the surface. And it also helps support the casing. And so if that cement becomes damaged, problems with it are, first of all, there can be lost production from gas being lost. There can be potentially dangerous operating conditions because high gas leakage can eventually lead to a blowout. And then there's a whole environmental and human health problems issue where people believe that, well, methane gas is a greenhouse gas, and so they believe that it could potentially be leading to climate change. And methane also can cause ground level ozone to form, so has multiple problems. So then what causes the cement to become damaged? There's several possible stresses that can occur in the cement sheath when pressure cycles are applied. And so first of all, taking a step back real quick, because I'm specifically looking at fatigue damage. And fatigue damage is damage that occurs when something is routinely pressurized over and over and over, usually at the same pressure, and it eventually fails at a pressure that's lower than what the strength of the material actually is. And this has been observed in wells. A lot of times cement will be placed and it doesn't see any compressive stresses that should exceed the strength of the cement, yet somehow it still shows signs of being damaged. And so they're starting to consider some of these other stress possibilities of the cement. So this is back to the pseudo well. And so what can happen is when this inner casing is pressurized, it expands radially and it can cause a compressive stress on the cement here. And the other thing that can happen is it can cause a tensile hoop stress on the cement. And this tensile hoop stress can eventually lead to radial fractures in the cement. And so then when the pressure is released in the casing retracts. And if there's a good bond between the cement and the casing, it can actually pull on the cement and cause a tensile stress in the radial direction. And the other thing that can happen is if the cement debonds from the casing, then there can be then what's called a microannulus can form, and so gas can flow through that. And a microannulus can occur at both the boundary between the cement and the casing and the cement and the rock. And there's other damages that can occur too. There's shear stresses that this could be exposed to depending on the orientation of how the well is in the ground. And then there's axial stresses as well, where this casing pipe can expand axially and cause shear stresses along the edge of the cement. But this research isn't really considering those things specifically. So to model this well, so we have this well and we want to model what happens to the cement in the well when it's subjected to pressure cycling. And so we designed this new laboratory apparatus that the hope to assess the fatigue damage of annular cement. And there are other people who have done things like this, but the difference between what's been done and what we did is ours can determine the time that the damage occurs, like the approximate number of pressure cycles. It can also determine the location of the damage in the actual apparatus. And from the mathematical model that I'll describe next, it can determine the type of damage from the data. And so this damage detection is based on a new concept using transient permeability theory. And so basically what we've done is we've applied a transient pulse to the cement and then monitored the decay of that pulse over a period of time to see what the decay curve looks like. And I just want to point out right now that this, even though we're using this transient permeability theory, we're not actually measuring the permeability of the cement. We're measuring a number that, using the same theory that's used to, using basically the same math that's used to calculate permeability from the data. And so this permeability that we're calculating is only useful if it's compared to other permeabilities calculated the same way. And so in the case of this experiment, we're calculating a permeability after every set of pressure cycles. And so then we can see the trend line of what's happening with that permeability as the pressure cycles occur in the cement. And so I just wanted to be really clear that this isn't the permeability of the cement. Like, we're not calculating a material property of the cement. And I think I'll talk about this later, but we're actually calling it something different just to distinguish that. And so we were kind of going to call it point source reference permeability. And the reason why is because it's applied with a point source, which is different from how permeability measurements are normally done. They're normally done with flow across a known area, and we just have a point source. And then there's also a reference permeability in that it's only useful if you have other permeabilities in the trend line to compare it to. So the data that we collected from this transient permeability theory, so we apply the transient pulse, and the data that we collected was the decay rate, so the pressure at time. So the pressure that the pulse was and the time, and data was collected per second. And so then I developed two mathematical models to calculate this point source reference permeability from this transient decay data. And I used known techniques of calculating permeability that are already really well established, and just took those and applied them specifically to this model, because there were a few differences between how it's normally used and how I was using it. And so for this first one, the slope method of permeability calculation by Brace, this is normally done with water, and we were using gas. Plus, he has two volumes with a rock cylinder in between, and he's flowing water, or really high pressure gas, through this rock cylinder over a known area. And so that's a little bit different from what we have, because when I talk about the actual apparatus, you'll see that we have a volume of cement on one side, and then we have the point source that flows into the cement. And so the second one is based on an approximate solution to the porous media flow equation. And the approximation used was a succession of steady states as described by Muscat. And then I also did a logistic regression model to determine the probability of cement damage in the apparatus after a certain number of pressure cycles had occurred. So this is a drawing of the actual apparatus used, and this shows this inner pipe, which is analogous to the casing, the outer pipe, and these two pipes are aluminum, so we can CT this. And then between the two pipes, I have a layer of hydrostone that simulates rock, and then I have a layer of the oil well cement that's like the annular cement in a well. And this inner pipe will be pressurized cyclically to it, and that's how we're going to determine what the effect of the cyclic stress is on this cement. And so these pseudo permeability measurements I was just talking about, the pressure pulse for that is introduced through these are 16th inch thick tubes that have been cured into the cement. And so, and I haven't slide with more detail of those, but basically they're pressurized to approximately 16 PSI, and the end of them is open to the cement. And so then we can measure, we have pressure transducers on each one that measure the pressure decay as this pulse decays through the cement at wherever location it is. And there's four of these. And so to design the thickness of this inner pipe, I used numerical simulations. And so I used two numerical simulations. I created one that I basically set up what the stresses in a generic in the cement in a generic wellbore might be. And I used a wide range of pressures and confining stresses for that, because there's not really they all have different, every well has different properties and is going to see different stresses, and it, like, there's just a lot of variability. And so I just tried to be really general and say, okay, this is the kind of stress that a lot of wells might see in the cement. And so then I also did a numerical simulation, or I made a numerical model of this apparatus, and I varied the thickness of this inner pipe until I was seeing stresses in the cement in this apparatus that were similar to the stresses I'd been seeing in the general wellbore model. And when I applied 3750 PSI to this inner pipe. And then this outer pipe design thickness. So we weren't applying confining pressure to this, and so we wanted to take into account the stiffness of this or the thickness of this pipe. And so that was designed using basically matching the stiffness of the aluminum to the stiffness of an infinite shale formation. And the material properties for shale vary quite a bit, and so I just used the ones that were on Engineer's Edge for shale. So this is a close-up of how this transient pulse is being introduced into the cement. So you can see this tube that is sticking in the cement, and it basically runs down the length of the hydrostone, and then where I want to take the actual measurement to determine, oh, is there damage around this area, the tube turns 90 degrees and sticks into the cement. And these tubes were put here before the cement was placed, so they've been cast with the cement. So then all this data that I ended up collecting from transient pulse testing. So basically for this transient pulse testing, I pressurized these tubes during the experiment, like when I was running pressure cycles. And then after I was done running pressure cycles, I would again put a transient pulse on that and then let it sit and watch what the decay was to see if there was a difference between the new one and the one that had been calculated from the previous set of cycles. And so to calculate, so we needed to calculate something from this data to make it so you could compare it. And so what we decided to calculate was permeability, but like I already talked about, it's not technically the permeability of the cement. It's something else, and I don't know what it is, but I'm calling it point source reference permeability. And so I calculated it in two different ways. First of all, one way to calculate permeability is this thing called type curve matching. And so that basically means that you solve the correct flow equation for porous media. So basically the one for gas or the one for water. And so we have gas, so I need to use the compressible form of this equation. And the problem with getting a solution for it is that it's a nonlinear PDE. And so that's where I already mentioned I'm going to do the approximate solution using the continuous succession of steady states. And so with that, you're basically assuming that the flow is a series of steady states, so that time becomes a parameter rather than an independent variable. And so for this method, the boundary pressure will vary with time. And so for each, at the boundary, each time the pressure changes, you say, okay, at 60 seconds, this is the pressure. And then at that time, there's an instantaneous steady state distribution in the cement. And so you just do that with each one. And so to solve this, first of all, you solve the steady state solution. And then from the steady state solution, you can calculate the mass flow rate in the cement using Darcy's law. And so that's an assumption of this math is that we're assuming Darcy flow. And the other thing, coming back to this one, some of the assumptions already built into this is, first of all, the viscosity, can vary with temperature, but I'm assuming that it's constant. And for the succession of steady state solution, the gas compressibility is assumed to be negligible. And so I'm assuming that because I'm using pretty low pressure in those 16th inch tubes, although there could probably be a discussion about that. I've thought a lot about it. And then K, this is the permeability, often varies by location, but I'm assuming that it's the same everywhere in the cement. So coming back to this, so then once you have the mass flow rate in the cement, you can calculate the mass flow rate from the boundary into the cement, and you know that those have to be the same. And so then you set the mass flow rate from the boundary and the mass flow rate in the cement equal, and then you solve the resulting equation for the pressure change at the boundary with time. So basically what I'm looking for with this is an equation that says d pressure at the boundary dt, so the change of this boundary pressure with time, and that is actually the data that I measured. And so this will probably make more sense with a drawing of the mathematical model. And so this is taking the apparatus and turning it into something that can be modeled mathematically. And so you can see the outer pipe, the inner pipe, the hydrostone, and the cement. And then this is this 16th inch tube that's embedded into the cement. And so you can see where the transient pulse is introduced right here at the outside of this inner pipe. And so it's free to flow along the pipe. If there's a microannulus or if there's not a microannulus, it will flow through the cement. And then P2 is atmospheric pressure, because this apparatus was open to the atmosphere at the end. And so P2 was basically constant. And so coming back to this, first of all, the steady state solution is pretty easy to solve. You just set the time part of this previous derivative, you set the dp dt equal to of time equal to zero. And so then you can apply the boundary conditions. So at p of zero, which is right here, that equals p1, and p of l is equal to p2. And then you can get this solution, and from Darcy's law and this solution, you can calculate the mass flow rate in the cement. So this is Darcy's law multiplied by rho and A to put it in forms of a mass flow rate. And then I know what dp dz is because I just can just take the derivative of this, and then I just plug that in here. And one thing that's interesting about this equation is this is the same equation that Muscat was using to calculate permeability and gas flow experiments. However, he was measuring the mass flow rate, and so he could use this equation directly to calculate what the permeability was. And in our case, we don't actually know what the mass flow rate is, and so that's why this other math is required. So then continuing with this solution, now that you know what the mass flow rate is in the cement, we need to know what the mass flow rate is from this volume. And so I'm just saying that all of this tubing that's pressurized to the 16 psi is a volume, and it's a known volume because I can calculate what it is. And so the mass flow rate from this into the cement will be this equation, and the dp1 dt is what we're looking for. That's how the pressure, that's this pressure change here with time. And so then I can set the mass flow rate in the cement and the mass flow rate from the volume equal and solve for dp1 dt, and I get this equation. And then this equation is a lot easier to solve if I say that, if I normalize the pressure. So if I say x is equal to p1 over p2, and then I can put the equation in this form where p2 is a constant, and then I can solve it. And so this equation is pretty easy to separate and integrate. So I just pull out this constant and I separate and integrate, and so for 0 to t, and then from x to xi, and this xi is the pi over p2, so pi is the initial pressure of the transient pulse, so basically p0. So if the transient pulse was 16 psi, pi is 16, and then it decays after that. And so this was the solution I got for x, and so remember the x is p1 over p2, so this is a normalized pressure. And everything in here is known except for C. And so what I can do, and the data I'm measuring, so I'm measuring basically this x and I'm measuring t, and so I can do a nonlinear regression to calculate C. And so then from C, I can calculate this point source reference permeability, because if I look at C, that's the only unknown other than this reference area. And I'm going to talk about that reference area really quick, because one of the sort of, I guess, assumptions we had to make with this math is the area, since it's a point source, the area that the gas is flowing through is actually unknown. And I tried a bunch of different areas. I tried different shape factors. I tried back calculating, like putting in a permeability that I thought should be a reasonable number to calculate from this, and then back calculating everything and trying to come up with an area that made sense. And what it comes down to is this experiment is looking at the permeability trends, so the differences in these PSR permeabilities. And no matter what the area is, it scales, since it's in this constant, it's going to scale all of the permeabilities that are calculated the exact same way. So the differences between them will still be the same. And so no matter what the area is, we're still getting the same result. And so because of that, I ended up just using something for area. And instead of calling it area, I'm calling it a reference area, because that's really what it is. So, and then this was the PSR permeability calculation using the slope method. So I have the same mathematical setup, but for this one, instead of using the like fluid flow laws, I'm just making an assumption that this can be modeled as a RC circuit. And so basically this volume that's pressurized is a capacitor, and then the cement is a resistor. And so then you can just write down the equation for the for first order transient RC circuit. And so that's this P1 minus P2, and they're squared because I'm dealing with gas. And then this is equal to P0 squared, and then multiplied by some decay, because I know that it's going to decay exponentially. And then I got this constant from the previous constant I'd already calculated using the gas porous flow model, but the difference is the constant for this one won't have P2 in it because I normalized this other equation with P2, but I didn't normalize this one with P2. So what I ended up doing was multiplying nu by the gas compressibility. And so then this is the gas compressibility, and the gas compressibility is 1 over P because I'm assuming ideal gas. And so the gas compressibility is the average, is calculated at the average pressure of the system. And so then once you have this equation, the way you can use it is you can take the log of both sides, and so you end up with log P1 squared minus P2 squared equals log delta P0 squared minus C of T. And then this is a straight line, so when you plot this data on a semi-log scale, you should get that the data should be a straight line, and then you can draw a slope, or you can calculate the slope of the line, and then the slope of the line is equal to this constant. So then from that constant, you can calculate the PSR permeability because everything is known assuming that you're assuming a reference pressure. And that's why this is called the slope method, because you're calculating the permeability from a slope. And this is just a comparison of the two solutions. I solved both of them for P1 of T. And so I used the same parameters in here that I used in most of my modeling. And so the viscosity was just the viscosity of the air at room temp, because I was using air to pressurize those 16th inch tubes. I know the volume of the tubing, the length, so the length of the cement is the point where the pressure transducer is physically located to the nearest end. And the reference area, gas compressibility, and then for this calculation, I had to put in a permeability, so I just put in 10 to the negative 13. And so these are the decay slopes that I get if I put in 4 hours. So this is a summary of these test apparatuses that I built. And so for apparatus one, going over this real quick, this shows the inner pipe thickness, and I ended up using 3 different inner pipe thicknesses. The max compressive stress that the cement would have seen based on that thickness, the maximum tensile stress, and then the total number of cycles applied. And so for apparatus one, there were only 105 cycles applied because there were some major problems that we weren't able to overcome. And so basically the experiment was pretty unreliable into whether or not it would actually work. And one thing with designing a new experiment is that you want it to be reliable so that it works every time. And so we ended up making a design change, and the next three all worked reliably. Apparatus three had an issue with the inner pipe casing burst after 5 cycles. And so it worked in that I was able to pressurize it, but this 0.05 inch thick casing was too thin for this experiment. I numerically modeled that and it looked like it should be good, but what ended up happening was that there was a void in the cement by the casing, and so where the void was, the aluminum pipe ended up with a much higher tensile stress than it should have, and it burst. So that one, I looked at the data from this one, but I didn't include it in much in the analysis because this is more data for what would happen if your casing pipe burst, which is a definite concern. I mean, it can happen, but that's not what this research was looking at. This research was looking at cyclic fatigue damage of the cement. Before you freak out about all the numbers on this plot, I want to just explain everything pretty carefully, and then and I think so there's a lot of data associated with this experiment, and I went through several iterations of what the best way was to present it, and so far this is the best way I've come up with. So this is from apparatus 4, and these are the baseline results calculated from these PSR permeabilities are calculated from that slope method technique. And so for the baseline for this, I ran three baseline tests. So you can see here that there's three tests, and then this, just jumping ahead real quick, so because all of the plots will look the same, because I decided the best way to do this was to come up with a set of curves for each experiment, and then these tables so that you can easily look at this. So looking at this table, so I know that this is the PSR permeability that was calculated from the slope method for this many number of cycles. So for instance, 434 cycles, this was what I calculated for PT1 and so on. And the way I have this coded is if there was a statistically significant change, and I determined that by taking the calculating the standard deviation of these calculated PSR permeabilities, and then if there was a change of one standard deviation, I said, okay, well, that's probably significant, and it means that there might have been a change in the cement. And so I ended up bolding that number. And then the ones in brackets show nonlinear behavior on these plots. So this is the data plotted on the semi-log scale, and then these lines are the slopes of the data. And so I thought this was a really quick way to look at this and see, okay, well, even though I was still looking at the baseline, for PT1, after 682 cycles, it looks like there was like something major happened in the cement because the permeability increased by 4 orders of magnitude. And same thing with over here. There's something going on in here, but then once you get down here, it's like suddenly there's this big increase again. And so this is an easy way to see when the increases occurred for each pressure transducer, and then look at them on the plot. So if you wanted to see what, so these are the, right now we're looking at the baseline ones, but if I wanted to look at like the zero baseline for PT1, that's this one, and I can see that the data looks fairly linear to when it's plotted on this in this method, and the same thing with PT2, and then PT3 looks pretty good, and PT4 looks pretty good. The issue with PT4 is there was this big change in the calculated PSR permeability between the first baseline test and the second two, and that shouldn't have happened because really there was nothing that happened in the cement, so I'm not sure why that occurred. But that also shows why why you need to be kind of careful analyzing these, because these really large changes where it's like 10 to the negative 14th to 10 to the negative 10, it's like that's pretty obvious something happened. But then there's some others like maybe like I mean, even this one, to 10 to the 14th to 10 to the negative 13th. That's a statistically significant change, but the problem is the same thing happened during the baseline, and so was this really pressure cycling, or was it just some error measurement from the experiment itself? And so analyzing these large jumps were pretty easy, and that's really what this apparatus was designed for. Getting some of these smaller changes was a little more difficult, but I think that I managed to show that it was possible to find those and make some useful conclusions from them. So this is the same thing. This is the exact same plot I was just, or a table I was just showing you. This is just different plots. So these are for the slope method. And so looking at these, so for four, so for instance, this is 439 cycles, and then this is what the plot looked like for that, and then 439 cycles over here, and then this is what the PSR permeability was that I calculated for that. And so what I just talked about, this one, these all look pretty much the same until you get to 6082 cycles, and then something happened to where the pressure drop is suddenly a matter of seconds. Like for all of these ones, the pressure's dropping off in about 2 hours. And this one, suddenly the full drop is probably like 7 or 8 seconds. And so this is pretty, I mean, just from the raw data, it's pretty obvious that something happened in the cement here. And so I'm going to go through these pretty fast because it, like, mainly I just wanted to show like how these plots were put together and how the, because I think that this system of plots and these tables is pretty interesting for looking at this data. So for PT2, you have, again, the, it basically looks about the same for all of these and it's linear, but then there's this big drop again after 6723 cycles. For PT3, it happens a lot sooner. There's some things going around in here. It's non-linearity. But then it drops off. And so after 36, 32 cycles, the pressure decay is like a matter of seconds for the rest of the tests for this pressure transducer. And then for this one, so this one actually showed what I've been calling a possible evolution of damage. And I say that because if you look at these are all pretty similar. But then you get over here, and after 4987 pressure cycles, suddenly this drops off fairly quickly. And then it happens again. Like over here, you have 6082 cycles, and then, so that's this one, and then 6723 cycles, that's this one. And you can see this in these PSR permeabilities too. So this goes from 10 to the negative 13 at, let's see, 3953 cycles. Well, I don't know if that's the first one. So 4987 cycles, you see a drop, and then there's another drop, and then some more drops. So I thought that was kind of interesting. So this is the same thing again, only this are the results from the analytic method. And so this is the normalized data, and the line is the calculated, is the line is the analytic solution calculated from the model. And so for PT1 and 4 and even 3, it appears to follow the model fairly well. For PT2, it appears that there's a slightly faster pressure decay in the data than what the model predicts there should be. And so for that, I was looking at that as, well, that might be a small microannulus, although in this case, it would be extremely small. And so then this is the same thing here. I have the baseline test plotted, and then going down this, so for the analytic method, I did this a little, I marked the plot or this table a little bit different. So the bold is still a statistically significant change. And then on this one, I just marked where these faster pressure drops than what the model predicted occurred. And so you can see, like for PT1, it was pretty much all of them. But for the other ones, it's after there's been basically significant damage noted. So going to PT1 matched the analytical solution pretty well through all the pressure cycling. And then after 6082 cycles, suddenly there's this huge drop. And this was already basically the same data from what I just talked about with the slope method. I just wanted to show this, how this looks for the analytic method as well. And so this is PT2, and you can see that these are all, like, the decay is slightly faster than what the model predicts, but it's still pretty close to the model. And then PT3, once again, you can see this major pressure decline at 10 to the minus 11. And then, so this is that one that showed the evolution of damage. And I think this is kind of interesting because even though there's these fast pressure drops occurring here, this appears to still be in the porous flow regime for at least 4987 cycles. And then after that, it appears to maybe increase to slightly faster than what that model predicts. And so I think that this might have started out as maybe some damage in the cement or an extremely small microannulus, and then over here, when the damage became worse, it progressed to a microannulus. So if I just summarize what I've seen real quick from those, this is a CT scan of apparatus 4, and I'm showing physically where these different pressure transducers were. And so you can see that on one side of this, this had, well, basically this entire thing, at the end of the pressure cycling, it appeared that there was a microannulus formed through the entire apparatus. And although for this PT4, I was a little unsure if that actually was a microannulus because it appeared that there was some damage in the cement first and then a possible microannulus. And so this is the data for apparatus 2, and I'm not going to show all the plots again because they're basically the same. I just think they're interesting to look at. But this is showing most of the damage in this one occurred after 2349 pressure cycles. So after 2349 pressure cycles, something happened to where all three pressure transducers had a huge increase in PSR permeability. PT2 didn't, but it eventually did once I got up to around 7,000 pressure cycles. And the thing that's interesting about this one is only two of the pressure transducers looked like it might be a microannulus. The other ones looked like they were still in the porous flow regime. And the other thing that you can see with this is these PSR permeabilities, where I think it might still be in the porous flow regime, are higher or lower than all of the ones that previously that had looked like microannular flow. And so this apparatus looks like it might have sustained some mixed damage. So one side of it, this side, for PT1 and PT3, looked like the flow, even after the damage occurred, remained in the porous regime. And for PT2 and PT4, it looked like there was a microannulus, although for PT2, the microannulus appeared to form much later. Like, whatever caused the damage in most of them at 2349 pressure cycles somehow didn't affect PT2. So for the logistic regression model, this is a model that estimates unknown probabilities for a linear combination of independent variables. And in this case, there's only one independent variable, and that's the number of cycles applied to the apparatus. And then the dependent variable is binary. And I thought that this, so in this case, the permeabilities are, the PSR permeabilities will end up being the binary variables. And I thought that this was the best statistical model for analyzing this data because it's really, I mean, if there's a large increase, it's pretty obvious, but the smaller ones, it's kind of dubious as to whether or not there actually was an increase and or a change. And so some of it's just kind of a mix of guesswork and statistical testing to see how big of a difference there is. And so this model seems So basically, I wanted, it seemed like it would be better to calculate the probability of a cement damage, not an exact number of, oh, after this many pressure cycles, there's definitely damage, because you can't say that with this. With this sort of thing, and with cement testing in general, a lot of times all you can know is that there's a probability something might break. And so anyway, the way that the logistic regression works is that there's, so you need a link between the binary variables and the independent variables. So the independent variable is this linear function, and then so you need a link between that and the binary data, and so that's done with the logit function or the logit function. And the logit function is just the log of the odds. And so what we want from this equation is P of x, and P of x is a probability that damage occurred after x number of pressure cycles. And so beta naught and beta one are the unknown coefficients that are being calculated in the regression. And I'm not going to talk about the details of that regression because it's beyond the scope of this, but the regressions, the logistic regressions were done in Minitab and MATLAB. And so this is how I converted the permeabilities into binary data for the logistic regression model. So this is still the same data that I already showed you for, this is for apparatus four, and these were calculated using that analytic model. And so you can see like the bold ones are the statistically significant increase. And then since I'm considering the apparatus as a whole, I actually have four trials. There's four chances that the permeability can increase. And so for each pressure transducer, if the permeability increased, I put in a one. And if nothing happened, I put in a zero. And so also, I had to make this assumption that once the maximum, what I considered the maximum damage that could be detected in this apparatus had occurred, then the model would receive a one. And the reason why is because if you didn't do that, you didn't end up with a sigmoid curve. And one of the assumptions of the logistic model is that your data follows the sigmoid curve. And I think that this is a valid assumption because basically for like say these ones, this pressure drop is a matter of seconds for these. So even if more damage happened in the apparatus, it's not going to show up on it's not going to show up in the data because it happens too fast, or the decay rate is too fast. And so I'm assuming that this is the maximum damage that the apparatus can detect. And so when you're putting in the zeros and ones, the one means that the probability of your is one that your event occurred. And so in this case where it's this maximum damage and no more damage can occur, that should be a one because that's the probability that damage occurred is one at that point. So anyway, I just go through and add all these up. So I have zero for that, zero, 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 and then I have one here, one. And so I just go through and do that for all of these. And I did this for apparatus two as well with the analytic method data. And so what I put in the model is the number of cycles, the trials, and the number of successes. And so this is what I got for apparatus one. And these circles are those that data that I put in. So these are the zeros, these are the ones, twos, threes, and four. And so the way you can interpret this is the y-axis is the probability of permeability change, and I'm calling that cement damage. And then the number of pressure cycles here. And so one way you can look at this is you can say, oh, well, if 4,000 pressure cycles occurred, then the probability of damage is about 0.25. And coming over here, P of x, so this line here, this is p of x, so this equation plots this line. And so the p-value for the coefficient was 0.001, so that's good. The goodness of fit test, the Pearson p-value was 0.981, so that shows that this is a really good model. However, the Hosmer-Lemonshow test showed 0.59, and so that means that this is more of a so-so model, but it doesn't surprise me because as far as running this logistic regression does better with more data. And so I had enough data for the models, but it was pushing the limit of what an acceptable amount of data would be. And so for this one, this is for apparatus 2. And so this was the equation it came up with. And so the p-value for the coefficient with the number of cycles was 0.001, so that's good. The goodness of fit test for the Pearson test, it was 0.668, so that means the model's so-so. The Hosmer-Lemonshow test showed 0.072, so that's basically saying that this is a bad model. But I kind of look at the whole picture, and this is showing that it's okay. So I decided to go with it because this is all the data available, so I can't add more data to try and make it better at this point. So this is comparing the two logistic regression results. So, and this is kind of interesting. So this is apparatus 2 and this is apparatus 4. So for 2, the damage had a higher probability of occurring sooner, even though the stresses were lower. And for apparatus 4, the damage had a probability of occurring later, but once it occurred at a faster rate than it did in apparatus 2. And also apparatus 4 had more signs of microannular flow. And so to visualize these, we did CT scanning. And so this is a slice, one of the slices from apparatus 4, comparing the before and after. And one of the issues with this was I didn't see anything in the CT scans that would indicate like signs of massive damage, and so I ended up also cutting up these, and I don't want to focus too much on this. I think it's interesting to look at them, but I didn't include any data from this in like making big conclusions because the act of cutting them up could have damaged the cement. And so that's why we were trying to CT and not cut them up. But when the CT scans weren't showing any differences, really, we decided to cut them up. And so I did see radial cracks in a lot of them that I cut up, and they were really small hairline cracks. And I don't know for sure if cutting them up caused those or if they were caused from the pressure cycling, but that's just something to look at. So then the conclusions. So this was so came up with a new test apparatus then that was able to detect the approximate location of damage and type of damage in annular placed cement. And then it could also detect the time at which the damage occurred from the number of pressure cycles. And then there were several interesting trends seen in the data. First of all, the apparatus that was subjected to a lower stress sustained damage sooner. However, the damage was a mix of cement damage and microannulus formation. The apparatus subjected to higher stress sustained damage later, but all four pressure transducers were showing signs of microannulus damage. And in the cases that showed an evolution of damage, damage appeared initially to be in the cement, but later progressed to a microannulus. And so my conclusions with this is, I think that when the cement, or when the overall cyclic pressure applied to the cement is low, the cement is more likely to sustain damage, that if you keep applying pressure cycles, it'll eventually form a microannulus. But if the applied pressure is higher, then the damage is more likely to go straight to a microannulus.